Welkom. Welcome. Hi. Is this better?
Yeah, way better. All right.
Hi, welcome. My name is Jasper de Koo. I'm from a company called BIM & Day here in the Eindhoven. And today I'm going to talk a little about working together on a sustainable design using ARCHICAD. First of all, let me introduce the company. We're based here in Eindhoven, in the Netherlands, and we also have an office in Granada, Spain. We're with a team of, in total, like 13 people. And it is all founded by Sander van Herpen, my boss. He founded BIM & Day in 2014 and still going strong today. We primarily started using LiDAR laser scanning for point clouds. Let me start the little movie. LiDAR laser scanning was our base core of operations. And we modeled on top of it. Let me explain shortly what how we make those point clouds. Basically, we have a laser scanner. And we shoot out millions of points in the surrounding area. And it collects all the data from that area. It's basically like a 360 picture where you can measure every pixel. With that, you create an image. And with that image, you go around the entire building, inside, outside, everywhere, to collect all the data from that building. Like you can see, you have a couple of spots. And it creates pictures. And with that, it's our base for modeling in ARCHICAD. You've got then the most accurate information there is. And yeah, it's our base. That's what we started with. After that, we also did, we started doing BIM coordination. So that means getting different models. Things happen between the companies. And one model from a constructor. You compare them together and see where the things go. Eventually, we also expanded to as-built model service for facility management. It's basically the same idea. You create those models of the entire building, and you hang more information to it. So with a push of a button, facility management can generate schedules. For example, for maintenance of the building, for specific windows, you can see what the durability is of that window. So yeah, a lot of information and very handy. But that's our core business. Now, how does it look like in practice? This is a project we did in Dussen, in the Netherlands. It's a church. We scanned the entire thing. We used the point cloud as a base. And as you can see, it's pretty accurate. Our measurement accuracy is like 2 millimeters. So even the top of the tower of the church, we can scan very accurately. And it creates this lovely, lovely model. As you can see, very proud of this one. We also, you see all the different bricks and materials. We do hang information on that. Like an NOSFV code, which is a Dutch coding system we use for materializing and telling what products are. And that way, that information tells us about what kind of material it is, isolation worth, and that sort of thing. But that's for our core business. I assume you guys shortly, BIM, Building Information Management, working together in a digital environment. To get the most efficient way of working, it's all about working uniform using open standards. BIM software, there are a lot of BIM softwares, a lot of file systems, interchangeability, all those softwares, it will be a mess if you don't have an open standard. So in the big world, we standardly use IFC structures to interchange with each other and between companies. And using those standards, we can interchange a lot of information with each other more efficiently to create a more sustainable design for future buildings. With BIM as a tool, for example, we have the MPG, which lends translated the environment prestation of a building. Nowadays, buildings have to confirm to an MPG, which is a specific number. If you don't survive well, you have to start design right over, creating new elements in that design. And the number represents the impact it has on nature. So the sustainability of products is getting tighter and tighter every day, the number you have to suffice. You also have Madaster, which is like a material passport of a building. So we put all that information into the building. We generate schedules. We put it in Madaster, which calculates and produces a lot of passports. And that passport will live on with the entire building for its lifetime. And we also have Bream and Bang, but that's a lot of extra information. Oh, cool. Better? Yeah. Hello? Better? Cool. Do we have to start over? No? All right, cool.
Can you guys in the back hear better now?
Better? Yeah? Okay, cool. Thanks. No props. All right. Let's put it to practice. We have a business case. It's called DC Magdeweg, and DC stands for Distribution Center. This is a model we worked on BIM and Day as being a BIM coordinator, also with an architect and a constructor. And we as BIM coordinators guided the entire process. So at the left, we have the architect model. It's a model in ArchiCAD. And at the right, we have the constructor model that was made in Revit, both exported in IFC format, so we could interchange the information with each other. And we clashed them. At first sight, it looks pretty good until you put some extra software on it, like BIM Collab. In BIM Collab, we can use the clash detection. And for example, in the picture at the left, everything that's right, that's red, that's a conflict. So there are agreements at the beginning. We have a BIM protocol. We have a lot of meetings saying, OK, you guys are going to do it this way. You guys are going to do it that way. Hard dates when you deliver those, and we clash the entire model. Apparently, some things went wrong. The constructor drew beams through the model of the architect, but that's part of the process. It's better to do it in this stage than finding out while building it. We have a lot of clash rounds, like four rounds before we give a go for the model. As you can see, everything that's red that wasn't modeled right. And if the building elements are finally modeled correctly with models, we do another clash purely for information. Is the information hanging on it correct, like a beam? Is that a metal beam? Is that has it the right level? Does it start at the ground floor? Does it say it starts on the ground floor? They can draw it if it's beginning from the ground floor, but if the information doesn't say it, then you have to do it over. And we check that information primarily with Solibri. I don't think you can see it right. All right. I've got the entire model right over here. I selected a roof panel. And at the left corner, you see some data about the panel. For example, it has a four-digit NLSFB. Consists of eight digits. The first push it further to a second job. You see the 2721 references to the existing NSFB code list. And first thing first, you see that the first one is 2711, and the six digit which we implemented of BIM and Day is the 2721.12. That's not corresponding. That's the first information clash we are getting. So the conclusion was that roof, which was modeled by the architect, made it non-constructive while it was a constructive thing. You go through the entire building like that, but there's more information. You can look at the identification that's given to the material. So in this case, it's a type roof, architectural. It's a metal roof plate isolated with some measurements. But its predefined type is a floor. So those little mistakes we're noticing, and that all has to be correct to export great information and have interchangeability between models. We also have the exact location, it's a roof site, some measurements. To the model, so in ArchiCAD or in Revit, you have put on the correct information as well. You can also, if it's like a composite, you can extort it. Make it separate. You can add all the information to every screw, to every plate, everything. And then we generate schedules. We do this manually. We divide it into little like the foundation here, just to keep it clear, because else you've got an Excel of 1,000 elements, which is not, it's not a good idea. And maybe, as you can see, this is what the location, NSFB 6-digit, 4-digit, subgroup for the NMD, which I'll explain. Category, which I will explain later on as well. And what it consists of, material, concrete, in work, measurements, everything. Another example, these are the roofs. It can be quite a lot. I'll zoom in a little. And as you can see, it all corresponds with each other. And these schedules is what you want to get for the information application in MPG, in Madaster, and that sort of things. And it all works together with the Nationale Milieu Database, which is a database from the Netherlands. Each country has its own database, but working very hard to expand it to make circular building more accessible, which the NMD consists of is a material library, very expanded. The lifetime of an material, all the information that there is, the origin, and people and companies can apply information themselves to the database, and is regularly updated, but that's still at the stepping stone, so it needs some more expansion. But the Madaster, which I mentioned earlier, works with the Nationale Milieu Database and very several other databases to get all the correct information and the material passport. And all those information clinging to the model, it gives a lot of advantages. Modeling itself makes the data visual and more understandable for companies, but also for the clients itself. It will make sure that design phase will go more efficient and with a lot of more detail to sustainability, which is, of course, nowadays a very big subject. Optimal information interchange between companies, between clients. It all starts with the little team you start off with the architect, with the constructor, installer, and us BIM coordinators. It's really important that the information is clear from the get-go, and so there won't be confusion later on. Because if you're building a standing in the foundation and you cover that information wasn't good interchange, then it's way more expensive. And the material passport that Mandaster produces at the end, it goes a lifetime with the building, so the information is always accessible. So it's more efficient. You only have to put in the data once. And that's it. Thank you for your information, or for your attention. Thanks.